So welcome everybody to HP Discover. Hopefully you all went to the keynote this morning at the Sphere. Some big announcements and big announcements with AI. And we're going to talk about AI here, right? More AI stuff here. So before we get started, I'd like to introduce myself. I'm Shrikant, and I lead the product management within HP's private cloud AI business unit. And I'll be joined by my co-speakers here, Patrick Schlachter from Bosch, and Isabel Essie from HPE. So let's get started here, right? You've seen this. The impact of AI, I think, is pretty well known. I don't have to talk about these use cases. I think we've heard about these use cases in other sessions, and many of you have been interacting in many ways with some of these use cases already, right? Recommendation engines, when you go shopping, Amazon tells you, you like this and maybe you like something else, right? Netflix, and so on and so forth. So these use cases have been, AI use cases have been around for a long time. But what's happening is new use cases are coming along these days, right? And everybody wants to have that ChatGPT moment where they want to use AI to power and transform their business, right? A couple of months ago, when OpenAI introduced Sora, I think, it was pretty amazing. I was blown away, right? You could pretty much describe in a natural language text some scenario I want to create a video of a rabbit wearing a hat, drinking coffee at the beach with sun rising in the morning. You could generate that video in 30 seconds, right? So that's the kind of power of AI. And what was even more amazing was I did see another business that came up leveraging that concept where they were targeting small and medium businesses. A small and medium business could go to them and describe the ad that they wanted to have it created. They could describe in few simple sentences what their business was and who was the target that they want to reach out to and what was the message that they want to create. And this company could take that description from customer within a matter of 3 or 4 hours, they could create 3 or 4 different ad versions, right? For just $150. Think about it, right? And what took many months to create a commercial, right, with lots and lots of people, now it's all possible within three minutes, in a matter of minutes and seconds, right? It's the power of AI. So it's unlocking new use cases, right? So there's no shortage of, whether the technology is going to work. The question is, what use cases is more applicable to my business, and how do I use that use case to unlock the business potential that I have, right? So this is all great, right? So everything is rosy and butterflies and rainbows, and everything is fantastic now, right? But the reality looks very different for enterprises, right? So this is a very staggering stat, and this is so true when I talk to so many different customers that are in the enterprise world trying to bring AI into their business. And this is also some stats from IDC and Gartner. And this says 70% of enterprises don't even have an AI strategy that's aligned to their business goals. Think about it, 70% don't have AI strategy. And very few AI projects actually go to production, which means most of the AI initiatives just fail. And even if they go to production, it takes forever to get there, right? On an average, it says about 7 to 9 months for a AI project to start as a pilot, to go into a production and show the ROI and the business value, right? It takes too long, right? Now, if we take a step back and try and understand what could be the reason that this is all happening, because we said AI is so great, everybody can use AI, and on the flip side, enterprises are struggling. Why is that, right? The reason, one of the many reasons, we'll talk about a few other reasons as well during this discussion, one of the many reasons is that oversimplification, right? Somehow, enterprises think, if I have data, which all enterprises have mountains and boatloads of data, we all know that. Somehow, if I throw AI and machine ML algorithms at data, I can create value, right? And that's not true. And I love this quote because I'm not making a religious statement by any chance here. This is a quote that I love because it says, the greatest trick the devil played is to convince everybody that he does not exist. But we all know the devil is always in the details, right? So devil is always in the details. And the detail looks something like this, right? So let's start with I'll walk through this. I know this is an eye chart, and this is an eye chart for a reason, right? This is an industry-accepted AI/ML blueprint. Most successful companies have this blueprint, and they have operationalized it. So the purpose for me is not to read through each and everything, but I'm going to highlight some of the key things that are very important, right? Let's start with the data, right? We all know that nobody's going to argue that, you know, enterprise data is very big. It's complicated. It sits in data warehouses. It sits in lakes. It's at the edge, in the cloud, from data centers. When Patrick comes and talks about, you know, he's going to speak about some of these challenges and how Bosch is addressing it as well, right? This is an enterprise reality, right? Now, most of this data is distributed. It's very diverse. And importantly, it is very complicated, very complex. Now, for a successful outcome for an enterprise, you have to derive value from data, right? That's what machine learning is all about. That's what AI is all about. How quickly can you find insights from the data that you already gathered? And what good decisions can I make with the data the insights that the data is giving me, right? To be able to build that insights, the number one thing that you need to do is to be able to connect to that data, right? The data is very complex, it's all over the place, but you have to find a way to connect to that data. And once you connect to the data, you have to build data pipelines so that you can bring the data in. It's not just bringing the data in, you have to cleanse the data, you have to transform the data such that it's in a meaningful format that's usable by downstream users like data scientists who can then work on this data, right? For data scientists to work, you need to be able to package up the common tools and machine learning libraries like Jupyter Notebook, PyTorch, you know, TensorFlow, and so many other packages, right, routinely work on. You need to be able to package and give all those tools to them so that data scientists can take this data and can build a model, train a model, tune a model. It's a very iterative process, right? They run a lot of experiments. They tweak a lot of parameters, and sometimes they call it as hyperparameter tuning. Think about, you know, what a hyperparameter. If you think about a large language model with 1 billion parameter, as what they call, each parameter is something that you can tweak and tune to get the desired result, right? So they do turn a lot of knobs, and it's a very iterative process, right? And many times it's a trial and error process. They tweak 100 different knobs and see which knob is really giving them the desired result, right? It's a very, very iterative process. You run a lot of experiments. You compare those experiments. And then finally, when you think you built a model that has the right accuracy that meets your business goal, you need to send that model, you need to store that model in a place that is accessible by everybody, right? To be able to do that, now a data scientist will have to have access to workflow capability, a pipeline that takes the model, puts it in, stores in a location called model registry, where one or more models can be stored, or one or more versions of the same model can be stored, because it's important to version control the models, because you want to be able to trace how that model was built, who built it, what data set was used, what versions of the data set was used, what hyperparameters were tweaked and tuned. So that's all in the model registry, right? Now it's all great. Now you have a data scientist that somehow managed to build a model. Now comes the ML engineer, right? ML engineer's job is to take this model and operationalize it, right? And when I say operationalizing, it's putting the model and running it so that you can use the model from your application to start running inferences. Think of like a ChatGPT, right? ChatGPT is a model. And to be able to put that model to use, you have a front-end chatbot interface that allows you to interact with the model, right? So for that to happen, you have to operationalize the model. And then it's not just a one-time activity. You have to constantly monitor the model, right? Whether the model is performing and it is meeting the accuracy requirements, right? And is it meeting the latency requirements? Or if the accuracy is dropping for whatever reasons, the accuracy can drop for many reasons. One, the model could have been trained on a data set in a test environment by a data scientist. But when the model goes to production, the data that's coming in could be very different, right? In that case, your model prediction may work very differently in production as compared to your test data set that the data scientist may have used, right? So you have to watch for that, right? And then sometimes the model accuracy may drop because, you know, the algorithms that was applied on a data, now you're seeing new data, the same algorithms may not be working properly, right? So all of this means the ML engineer will have to ship the model back. The model has to be retrained and redeployed, and this cycle continues, right? So this is a very complicated process. Now you see that it's data plus AI equal to value is changing into something, a picture that looks something like this for an enterprise, right? Now you may ask, right? Everybody is getting excited about generative AI, and everybody wants to have a ChatGPT moment in their environment. How do you bring generative AI into this mix? And when you start thinking about bringing generative AI into an enterprise, what are some of the challenges that you have to deal with? The first thing, again, more data, right? You need more data to train a large model. You need more data to tune a large model. And second, you need more compute resources. Compute these days equates to GPU. And we all know, you know, how difficult it is to get access to one of those GPUs. In fact, I was talking to my team, engineering team. We have a cluster that's running in public cloud simply because we don't have those GPUs in our own data center. And they are scared to release those GPU resources because the minute you release it, there is no guarantee that you'll get it back tomorrow or a month later, right? The GPUs are expensive, but everybody wants it, right? When you think about large models, you need more GPU. And just to put this in context, right, a 1 billion parameter model, large model, needs at least 4 GB of GPU memory in full precision, 32-bit precision. Now, even if you cut that precision to half, right, and say, I want to go with floating point 16, and I want to store that model, you still need 1 billion parameter. You need 2 GB worth of GPU memory, right? Now, think about, you know, deploying a 100 billion parameter model, which is very common, right? You see Llama 3 introduced 80 billion parameter model, and now they are talking about coming out with a 480 billion parameter model in July, right? So models are getting bigger, so therefore, your compute requirements are also getting bigger, right? So you need more compute, right? And then the last thing, which is not the least thing, which is the most important thing in my mind, is when you put a large language model into production, you have to think about the safety and compliance, right? You don't want the model to be saying something that can be considered toxic or offensive or seem to have some kind of a racial bias or violating copyright and so on and so forth, right? Nobody wants to be in the headline for AI gone wrong, right? So everybody wants rainbows and butterflies with AI. Nobody wants to be in the headline for wrong reasons, right? So that means you need to start thinking about how do you wrap guardrails around your large language models, right? So this means not only do you have to deal with all the challenges that I talked about in the previous, but there are more challenges that are coming in with large language models, right? Now, let's look at one more time what the new blueprint is going to look like when you introduced generative AI into this mix, right? So you have to pretty much do everything that you did for a typical classic ML machine learning, deep learning model, right, which is what something that we've all been used to for the last however many years. We're all, you know, many enterprises are comfortable deploying classic machine learning model. You have to do all of that. Now, when you introduce large language model, you have to worry about a lot more. And this is the new blueprint, which extends the old blueprint. Keep that in mind, right? So not only do you have to worry about building your data engineering pipeline, workflows, you know, all the ML frameworks that the data scientist needs, the model serving framework, and all of that stuff, in addition to that, you also need to worry about, you know, how do I feed my enterprise data to a large language model that's been trained on public data? It has no understanding of my enterprise private data. How do I make it smarter such that when I ask a question to a large language model about my enterprise data, it knows how to respond? And to be able to do that, you need to have something called as RAG pipelines, retrieval augmented generation. It's a very fancy way of saying, I'm going to take the enterprise data, I'm going to chunk it up, cut it up in smaller pieces. I'm going to take each of those chunks that are similar in both context and meaning and group them together. I'm going to store them in a place called vector database, right? So this is something, it's too technical, and some of you may have been aware of VectorDB and all of these things that everybody talks about in the context of RAG. But the idea here is that I have to take my enterprise data, I have to group them based on the meaning and the context of the data and store them in VectorDB. So anytime you are introducing a VectorDB, that means you need to operationalize yet another database, right? You need to think about how do I operationalize a vector database? How do I scale that? How do I make it highly available? It's adding more complexity, right? Then you also need to think about, you know, embedding models. I'm not going to get into that. It gets too technical. But the idea here is that you are extending your complexity from an older blueprint to a new blueprint, which has a lot more capabilities. And then you have to worry about, you know, all the guardrails that we talked about, right? So how do I build the safety around these things such that, you know, I don't want my LLMs to say wrong things. And if, even if it does, I want to be able to catch it, block it, and stop it, right? So guardrails. And then finally, and this is for customers that are getting a little advanced in their LLMs, most often what happens in, is that in the AI journey, Gen AI journey, a lot of enterprises take off-the-shelf model. Maybe they want to bring in a Llama model, Mistral model, or a commercial model and just use it as is. Occasionally, what they also want to do is, like, you know, they want to fine-tune this large model to a very specific use case, right? Because it's great for the model to know everything about the world, but they, you know, enterprises don't really care about that, right? They want the models to know more about the domain that they're in. If you're a healthcare customer, it doesn't matter if the large language model knows everything about the history, right? It doesn't mean anything to me, right? So this is the process where you take a generic model and customize it to your use case, right? That process is called fine-tuning. And that requires a whole other set of tools to be able to do that, right? So now what has happened is, when you think about generative AI, you have to have all the workflows and tools that you had previously, and now you need to add additional things that makes the whole situation more complicated, right? Now you may ask, okay, great, I'm an enterprise, I'm very daring, I want to be able to, you know, somehow I'm going to muster my courage, and I'm going to go ahead, I'm going to do this, right? I'm going to, you know, I'm going to go on, nobody can stop me. Then you run into this brick wall, right? And this brick wall is all the tools that are available for you to go build the blueprints that I showed in the previous slide, right? And now you go and scratch your head and thinking, oh my God, okay, this is too many tools. Which tools do I use, right? And there are a lot of tools. And do these tools interoperate with one another? And does it break? And do they have security controls around it? And how do I upgrade, keep up with the different versions of these tools that are coming in, lifecycle management, and that's not a one-time thing. You know, once you're in for life, it's like a hamster wheel. Once you get on that treadmill, hamster treadmill, you keep running, you cannot get off of it, right? You need to think about that. And then you think about, okay, there are many components that could be open source, some could be commercial vendors. If it's open source, who do I call? If I'm, you know, bringing in too many commercial vendors, you know, who's going to take responsibility for, you know, coordinating across all of these? It just becomes too much, right? And this is one of the reasons, these are the reasons why you saw the stat that we saw earlier, right? 70% of the enterprises are very worried about lack of AI strategy because they are unable to make up their mind to get to this stage, right, where they can. And this is one of the reasons why we, HPE, we've decided to build HPE Ezmeral software. This is going to be the core underpinning for private cloud AI, the big news that came out today in Antonio's keynote, where we are building a turnkey solution to simplify all of this. At the heart of all of this is the HPE Ezmeral software. We're also calling it as AI Essentials. We'll talk more about it. But the idea here is that, you know, all the challenges that you saw, we want to abstract all those challenges away from you. So we bring a curated set of tools and a tailored persona experiences, like, you know, there's data engineers building data pipelines, bringing data, cleaning data, then there's ML engineers, data scientists building models, and then there's ML engineers putting the model in production. All of these guys will have to come together to make this symphony happen, right? So this software that we built not only brings all the tools, it creates a very cohesive, frictionless workflows to enable the enterprises to quickly get, adopt AI and quickly get to outcomes. Now, if you don't trust me, I'm going to bring in Isabel here, and she's going to do a live demonstration here, and then you can see how this product works in action.
Thank you, Shrek. So before we head into the live demo, maybe just a quick overview of what Ezmeral Unified Analytics is. So Shrek already mentioned it. The announcement you've seen this morning, Private Cloud for AI, the basement it's built upon on Ezmeral Unified Analytics, also known as AI Essentials. So we see here some logos, but you have to admit it's way less logos than we've seen before. So still you have multiple tools to realize several purposes. So we have different personas working on it. So data engineers, we need to do data acquisition, preparation. So if you do shit in, shit out, I mean, if you have not the right data, you have not cleaned it, then your AI model cannot predict well. So that's why you still need all the steps. And for all of these steps, we have different tools in our SML Unified Analytics. So it's all in one platform, still a lot of tools, but every tool has one single purpose and you don't have to choose between one purpose and 200s of tools. So what we see here, maybe some of you know some of the logos. So Presto, for example, for getting all the data, Airflow you can build pipelines with, Spark you can analyze the data. You may have also heard about machine learning development environment or other of the ML tools, so MLIS or MLDM. So that's also integrated for training your model, doing hyperparameter optimization. And we also have a solution, of course, for the model registry. So when you have several versions of the same model, you need to retrain, you need to store it somewhere. That's MLflow, what we use here. We have a feature store in place with Feast, Kubeflow for the training pipelines, and also we have solutions for monitoring. And of course, Jensen was today on stage. Of course, we work together with the NVIDIA tools, so with the enterprise AI tools from NVIDIA. You can also see the live demo of the private cloud of AI on our show floor, and then you can see there how it all works together. You may have noticed on the bottom there's the data fabric, so that's our solution for the other challenge we had with the distributed data, so in silos, some of them in the edge, some of them in the cloud, not connected together. Maybe you have also different locations all around the world, but you want your data scientists to get all of the data in so you can have the perfect AI model, which works everywhere. So this solution is then called SML Data Fabric, which brings together all of your locations, all of your sites, and everything can run at the edge, which we will see later also in our Bosch example, but also in the cloud or in co-locations with GreenLake. So let's check if live demo is always a bit exciting, if it works. Yeah, perfect. Okay, so here we can see when I log in, what it looks like. So let me get the mouse over here. So that's what it looks like. We can see on the very right also the top framework. So you can see we just collect the data, what you are currently using, so that you later on know, okay, which of all of those frameworks we've seen is actually causing my bug. And we also have at the very top, you can also see how much CPUs or GPUs and system resources you're using. Now, what's very interesting is if we go here to the left, so we have different kinds of people working with it, right? So the data engineer, the data scientist, all of them work together to get the same project on the road. That's why we have this burger menu, so everybody can just access their own tools which we've seen before. So for example, you need to first get access to the data, so connect to your data, that's the data sources, that's something the engineer, data engineer does. The data scientist just expects the data to be there for him to work. So that's what he's not gonna worry about. He worries about the analytics part or about the BI reporting or about the data science, so actually like training the model. If we go to tools and frameworks, we can just see the same tools. You can head over the burger menu, but in an other overview, and you can also see that you can import a framework, so we will learn a little bit more about how Bosch does that, but you can also have your custom apps. So maybe you need still an application, for example, here at the very bottom, which will actually use your model. So you have trained your model, but you want to use it in a virtual chatbot or in another application, in self-checkout, in a retail store, anything. Maybe you want to run that in the same ecosystem, and that's possible also with us. So you can just import anything that's Kubernetes ready. You can just import here, also over the UI. You don't need to worry about a Kubernetes cluster. You can just go ahead and import it here. So that's what it looks like. Just a quick overview. Some of you may realize, hey, what about the NVIDIA AI tools? It's not here yet. That's true. It's going to be just an additional site here, and you can see all of the tools there and also some examples ready just to click and launch your AI first AI project. So check it out on a demo booth. It's worthwhile. But for now, we will head back to this slide. So that's SML Unified Analytics, and I will head back to Shrik to introduce our customer.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Sibyl. I think the simple way to think about all of that is we give a very curated set of all these tools and a self-service access to data sets and the tools for different personas so they can interoperate, collaborate, and in the process, accelerate the journey to AI, right? So that's the message that that we have. And now is the interesting part. You know, if we have Patrick, I'm going to have Patrick come over here. And Patrick is from Bosch. come all the way from Germany to share their stories about how they built a digital twin and the lessons that they learned along the way and other thoughts he wants to share. So Patrick.
Right. Yeah, thanks a lot for the nice intro. Yeah, so I'm Patrick from the Bosch side, and we're building digital twins, basically. So digital twins are nowadays used for many different things. It's like a buzzword for almost everything. So let me start by giving you a context of the industries that we're targeting. So we're mainly in targeting the energy industry or industrial, like critical industrial infrastructure, and also in the process industry or discrete manufacturing. And in those industries, you always have common challenges. So one is, for example, seeing and hearing the symptoms of industrial machines. So it can be like a simple pump. It can be also like a conveyor belt, as you can see here. Those machines seem far away from generative AI and very, very simple machines. But actually, if they fail, usually this is tightly coupled to the complete business process. So for example, in steel industry, those conveyor belts bring like some material from point A to B. And point A and B are usually like hundreds of kilometers away from each other. So if that conveyor belt stops because of some, let's say, slip in the driving unit, it's like the complete process stops, and it has a direct, huge impact on the business outcome. Another challenge is managing distributed assets. So here on that image, you can see like dewatering pumps, for example. Those pumps are distributed across like various geographies, and again, they're difficult to access. And if they fail, someone needs to go there first. It has again a big impact. Another thing is reducing the time on repetitive tasks. So here you can see how preventive maintenance is being done. So for example, those transformers need to be checked regularly. Which is like a tedious task. You don't know whether it's actually the right time to change your critical components or not. So you're just following the standard process without doing like maintenance in a smart manner. And finally, seeing the invisible inefficiency is also something very challenging. So if you think of those power plants, like complex processes. You don't even know that you're maybe not running on at optimal efficiency. You have no methods to do what if scenarios. What if I change certain parameters? Maybe my efficiency would go up. Usually, there half a percent of efficiency again has a huge impact on your overall business outcome. So those are the challenges that we're tackling by this solution. And in short, like managing industrial assets and processes is tough and often business critical. So how do we do it from the Bosch side? We basically make machines speak, and this is literally the case. So the machine can ping you, for example, on Teams, or can call you if there's some issue. And how do we achieve that? By building digital twins, which is like a digital replica of your industrial machines, based on the physics of the machines, based on AI, and also based on simulations. In order to achieve that, or in order to use that digital twin framework, we take all the data that is there, that is generated by the data, by the machines. It can be like, it can come from processes, like process data from PLCs. It can come from additional sensors that we attach to the machines. And the outcome are decisions, or rather insights that we get either in the engineering space, so something like that your machine will fail in 20 days. We also calculate the remaining useful life of critical components. It can also be in the operational space, so something like your overall equipment efficiency can be improved if you change certain parameters. And it can also be in the business, like, or it can be mapped to business, the same amount of information, so that, for example, you can optimize your cost for spare parts if you optimize certain parameters in your process. So in short, we take the data that you have and we give back the data that you don't have. That's the overall idea of those digital twins. So you can also see it like a doctor for machines, you know, detecting the symptoms, detecting faults before they arise. This is basically the core of the solution, and we integrate that into our overall, let's say, solution, our Bosch Digital Twin integrated asset performance management solution. So there you can see in the middle again, we have the software, with the digital twin core, where we fuse physics, AI, and simulation, and we build hybrid models. But we also have sensors, of course, somewhere we like this data needs to come from. And on the right, obviously, we have like additional services. So it can be like a insight only, what I showed you before. But it can also be like recommended actions that you have to take, or like a specific action, for example, for an operational manager or a production manager. And this is also based on causality. So it's by fusing the domain knowledge with AI and with simulation, we try to get like the best of all the three worlds together, so that it's not only data-based and not only based on the physics, for example, but we try to combine everything. So this is like an overview of our solution. However, we had the following technical challenges. Like, what to do if we have huge amount of data? What should we do if we have like terabytes of data coming in every day, for example? What if we need like very low latency for some, like if you think of a gas turbine or you know, like a very critical machine, it's, you cannot wait for a minute, or you cannot wait for, you know, like even 30 seconds maybe. You need to be able to quickly react. And another issue is data privacy. Many customers are hesitant to put their confidential data, even though it's only sensor data, to the cloud, because the way like the process is implemented, their processes are implemented, is maybe quite confidential. So that's also a common challenge that our customers are facing. Another one is connectivity. You can also see that oil rig here, or if you also think of an offshore wind park, you cannot send like terabytes of data every day or every hour to the cloud. In some countries, also cloud is just not available. And there are other good reasons, like immediacy versus depth, which can be solved by having like compute power at the edge, or even sustainability. So it also makes sense to a certain extent to process the data where it arises, instead of, you know, sending it across the world. So those were our reasons to basically partner with HPE and to bring our solution to the edge. And this is exactly where HPE basically helps us. So we call this twin in a box, because this twin, digital twin, is now in a box which you can place anywhere in the world, and especially you can place it next to your asset, so exactly where the data is created. So this box is connected to the industrial assets, obviously, to sensors or process data, but it can also be still connected to the cloud. So it's like a full hybrid solution. Depending on the use case, we can decide whether we have like 100% at the edge or 100% at the cloud or something in between. And let me also give you like a high level overview of how that box is structured. And on the lowest level, we have HPE hardware. So it can be like an edge line server, for example, or like DL360, like different HPE hardware. Then we have a hardware virtualization layer, and then we have the Asmerel Unified Analytics as a platform that we build our application on top. So this becomes like basically the interface between, let's say, the HPE infrastructure and our application. So we can basically focus on what we're good at, namely building the digital twin, focusing on the physics, on the AI, on simulations of those large industrial machines. And the, let's say, the burden of operationalizing that, providing support also for our end customers, and deploying it anywhere in the world is basically, yeah, given to the HPE side. That's the whole idea. If we now dive, like, if we go one step deeper, those are the tools that we, for example, use. So you have also seen it in the slides by Shrik or Isabel. Yeah, for example, for orchestration, we're using Airflow, which is already readily available. We're using MLflow for model registration and also experiment tracking. And we're also using Kubeflow for to serve our ML models. And of course, we also have a bunch of custom apps, for example, for the OT integration, like sensor connectivity, or to deploy or to run our simulations, and our own dashboard, and also AR or VR applications are being integrated by that possibility of integrating custom apps into the platform. Yeah, so overall, the business outcome is that, first of all, we drive innovation. So that's what I said already at the beginning, that this is the goal, to run plant operations under optimal cost mode and optimal efficiency mode. We also envision, or we create a blueprint for reliability-centered maintenance and total productive maintenance. It's also possible to retain your domain knowledge within the organization, because there are many people who are sitting in front of a machine and knowing for our end customers and knowing the machines very well, but retaining this knowledge within the organization is very tough, and that's why integrating it into digital solutions makes total sense, so that those people can focus on innovation instead of for example performing those repetitive tasks that I showed to you in the beginning. Connecting is also a good part of the solution, not only connecting machines with insights, with decisions, with actions, but also connecting people. We saw it on the slide before that data scientists, ML engineers, data engineers can work together on one common platform, and we can even extend that by that solution to operational people, engineers of those industrial machines, and even the C-suite, who has one common solution to manage or to get an overview or insights into the plant operations. The whole solution is also built in such a way that it's scalable. So we have blueprints available for the most common industrial machines. We call those templates, and this is makes sure that we can basically deploy the solution quickly. So if you have a wind turbine or a gas turbine or a critical component, we have a template of which sensors to use, which models to use, which insights to generate already available, and we only need a short customization period to deploy it in your organization. And finally, with that collaboration with HPE, we're now able to deploy our same solution that we had previously anywhere in the world, because we can deploy it in a box. We can just place that box next to the asset, and we can help organizations to optimize their business outcome. That's it from my side. I'll hand over back to
Thank
you.
Thank you. Shrik. Thank you. Thank you, Patrick. That was amazing. You can see that how customers are really this is a classic edge use case, right? We don't think about AI. We usually think about large use cases, data centers, a lot of GPUs. But the AI going to the edge has its own challenges. And Patrick kind of explained how it all came together for them. Now, the last, our focus with our software is to enable customers focus on productivity and innovation rather than focusing on which tools to build what tools do I interoperate? How do I lifecycle manage? We handle all of that for you, right? So you can focus on business outcomes. And then going back to the announcement that we made, right, this morning, Antonio talked about it. Now, all of the software goodness is now available as a turnkey appliance, private cloud AI appliance, in partnership with NVIDIA. There's more announcements coming tomorrow, Fidalma's keynote, so I'm not gonna steal the thunder there, but I definitely encourage you to go to the booth. We are showing the product in action right now. But the idea here is that we want to be able to get you the hardware, software, everything pre-configured, AI optimized, complete full stack solution co-engineered by both HP and NVIDIA to solve for some of the biggest AI challenges that enterprises are facing. And the idea here is that very simple, right? We want to be able to give enterprises instant AI productivity. So nobody should wait for 7-9 months to realize the benefits of AI, right? So you have, like, everybody should have the ChatGPT moment, like, right now, right? That's the whole idea behind this. And then we talked about the data being diverse. So, you know, how do you bring data? How do you improve your time to value? Because the best data delivers the best outcomes, and getting to the data is so much more important, right? And then, of course, giving you that enterprise readiness, right? And giving you the confidence and the ability to have more control over your own data and privacy. And then wrapping all of this with GreenLake Cloud Experience so that you can manage, orchestrate all of this through GreenLake platform for a variety of different use cases. So this is what we are delivering as Private Cloud AI Appliance. The appliances are live. We are showing the live product on the show floor. More announcements coming tomorrow. Stay tuned for Fidalma's keynote. It's going to be amazing. And you'll see a lot more exciting stuff. So that's all we had for today. So I really appreciate you all coming in and staying for the session. I know there are a lot of other great sessions going on at the same time. So thank you so much for coming in.